divided against itself cannot stand. So said President Lincoln when the country was being torn apart. Then, an economic issue deeply divided Americans. Communities were torn apart over the economics of slavery. Are we nearly at a point again where Americans can't talk civilly about voting rights, affordable health care, and housing? Congressional candidates Vern Buchanan and David Shapiro joined the discourse. I'm Renee James Gilmore. Welcome to Black Almanac. Welcome to Black Almanac. Yep. Of course, we want to talk today about political issues, but before we even start talking about political issues, something I'd like to hear your position on. Are we at a point in this country where we cannot speak civilly about things that we disagree on?
I'd like to think not. I believe that, you know, everybody should have an opinion, their thoughts, their ideas. Hopefully out of that, the best ideas come to the surface. It's been a tough process, especially the last couple of weeks. And it's really been probably pretty tough for the last year or two. But what you don't see, I see in Congress, Elsie Hastings, African-American from the Fort Lauderdale area, we co-chair together the Florida delegation. And we do work together on getting a lot of things done, whether it's citrus greening, offshore drilling, a lot of different issues for our veterans, small business. I just talked to Elsie the other day when we were finishing up our session, and we talked about our big thing going forward, of course, is going to be all the water issues. We have the third largest delegation in the country, 29 members of Congress, and we co-chair it together.
Are you pressured by either side because of this, because you all do work together? Because it seems that just from outside looking in, when we watch television, it seems like any person that comes forward and says we're going to work together seems to it seems to have a lot of scrutiny placed on them by their own party.
I can tell you a lot of people, the number one issue locally for me is dysfunction in Washington. But when you get up to Washington, I've got all these working relationships. Some of my best friends are Democrats. I mentioned Elsie Hastings. You could call him and tell him what's Vern to work with. But the bottom line is we do get a lot of things together done. But when the cameras are on, especially during the political season, a lot of that dynamics change. I couldn't get a lot of the things I do get done, like the veterans ID card and a lot of other things, unless I worked with Democrats.
You know, one of the perceptions among some people is that we send people to Congress, and when they get to Congress, particularly in these last year and a half or so, the question becomes, who are you really working for? We were in the community very recently, and there were a couple of questions that were posed, and I'd like to present one to you.
Okay.
From a member of the community who wants to ask about your position and how you are interacting in Congress and who you're representing. So okay. Let's listen to that question.
Okay, sounds good.
I would like to ask both candidates, will they represent all the people, or will they represent the Trump administration?
Well, I can tell you my position. I think everybody that knows me, I work for the district. I tell young members that come up there, if you start working for the people up in Washington, you're going to get fired quickly. I work for everybody. That's the mindset I bring to it. Anybody that knows me, I'm going to fight for what's important to our issue. For example, like offshore drilling is a big issue. There's a lot of members on my party that like to drill closer to the shore. I work closely with Debbie Wasserman. In terms of a bill that we have together to make sure that that doesn't happen. Or in terms of veterans issues, I mentioned that we work together as a delegation. There's a lot of issues, Democrats and Republicans, very proud of. We get every Democrat and every Republican in Florida together on a lot of issues. Some are my bills, but many times are bills that we do together.
Healthcare is one of the issues that also comes up quite a lot. And both sides of the House say that healthcare for people is an important thing. When it comes to talking about access to affordable health care, no matter how you cut it, one of the things that people often are concerned about when they talk about health care is, am I going to be able to get a plan that I can afford and a plan that has pre-existing conditions taken into account? From your position in Congress, how can you impact that, and what's your position on health, universal health care.
Well, I think, and again, our delegation, we have to work together, Democrats and Republicans. Healthcare has skyrocketed, not just in terms of Obamacare. Set that aside for a minute, but I say the last 20 years, the cost of healthcare for a family of four is outrageous. I read something in the paper the other day where 62% of Americans don't have $1,000 in the bank. And a big part of that is healthcare costs have got so expensive. I know businesses that are in town where they pay $700 themselves, small businesses, but the employees have to pay $700. Then they have a $7,000 deductible. So if you don't have $1,000 in the bank, how do you have health care? We've got to make sure it works. I can tell you the first bill when I got to Congress was to support SCHIP, which is health care for children, for all the children, regardless of income or their circumstance in terms of their parents, is to make sure everybody has that. But that's something we have to clearly work together to bring down costs. I think it's one of the, if not the biggest issue, one of the biggest issues we've got in Washington. But that's something I hope our delegation can lead and take to Washington.
Together?
Together.
And at this point, can you talk a little bit about what you have accomplished together on that end?
Well, we have, like, for example, Florida citrus, the citrus industry. They had about 90% devastation. We were able, because of the hurricane and because of citrus greening, we've been able to put together a bill. I think I got every member of the Congress, is my bill, in terms of creating more incentives so they can attract capital to replant. Flood insurance is an ongoing issue. It's not a Democrat or Republican issue, but it's a big issue here in Sarasota and Manatee counties, is to make sure there's affordable flood insurance. So that's something we clearly work on. And then in terms of veterans' benefits are a very big issue. We want to make sure every veteran that's earned a benefit, they get it. And that's not a Democrat or Republican issue. It's all of us working together on issues like that. Or I'd say the other thing is on SCHIP, I said children's health care. That's something I've led on. That's something I've been have a consistent record on, to make sure every child has access to health care, regardless whether the family can afford it or not.
And clearly health is impacted even by the conditions that we face. We talked a little bit ago about environmental protections. We have a question from a community member about environmental protection, and I'd like to have you to respond to that question.
Great.
Our waters in Florida is increasingly becoming more polluted. I would like to know what he would do to try to help control the pollution of our environment, especially our oceans that are offshore drilling that is allowed.
I got endorsed as a Republican in Florida from an ocean organization in terms of them. I've been involved with Moat Marine. I've been on the board, I think, 6 or 7 years. I was vice chairman. I got a bill that I introduced for $8 million we just got for red tide research. But we got to have quality water. It's not even an option. It puts everything at risk. It puts Florida at risk, whether it's Lake Okeechobee or here locally. So we got $8 million that we're funding now that I got. We got another $15 million we're going to get, I think, shortly. And then we've got a package myself with a Democrat where we're looking for $100 million to get it to Moat and other marine science facilities so we can make sure that we start addressing what the causes are. It's a natural occurrence, a lot of it, but there's also a lot of other human factors, and we need to get that addressed. And then on a bipartisan basis, Democrats and Republicans will make sure they have the resources that they need to take on red tide or the algae bloom that's over in Lake Okeechobee.
Are you working on that right now?
We're working on it right now. We just got the $8 million. I work closely with the CEO of Moat Marine. We talk all the time. He's in my office all the time. I make sure he's got what he needs, and they've got a lot of new technologies that they're using to figure out even how to get red tide out of the water. So I think we're making good progress, but it's something that's got to be the number one top priority. Healthcare is a huge issue, but as it relates to Florida and our delegation, Elsie and myself, we're going to make sure the number one issue for Florida is water quality.
So important, because as we all know, everything goes into the water.
Yeah.
We've been talking for decades now about what happens when people put fertilizer on their lawns and everything going into the aquifer one way or the other. So that's good to hear. Let me ask you a question as it regards, as we're talking about voting rights. In 1965, we had the historic piece of legislation, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, trying to align people's actual voting practice and their ability to exercise their constitutional right to vote. So here in the state, as you well know, there's an amendment called Amendment 4 on the ballot that has everything to do with restoring automatically the voting rights of felons. And while that is a state issue, at the federal level, we also have observed for some time now that there have been chipping away at the 1965 Voting Rights Act. Your position on voting rights, particularly as it regards Florida, given that we are the one of only three states still that doesn't restore rights to felons automatically. You have any thoughts on that?
Well, I think everybody should be given a second, even a third chance in life. None of us are perfect, and I think it's something that seriously needs to be looked at from a Florida standpoint. My focus is more on the federal, and I would just tell you that everybody that's an American citizen, and many people that you're talking about, they need to have access and make it as easy as we possibly can for them to be able to vote. It's not something I work on every day, to be candid about it. I work on a lot of small business issues and lowering taxes for people, but it's something that clearly everybody that is eligible to vote should definitely be able to vote, no questions about it, and make it as easy and accommodating as we possibly can.
We talk often, or we hear often, about at the federal level, especially within the last year or two here, about voter fraud. Do you think there's voter fraud going on in Florida?
I don't think so. I mean, I know I work with three counties. I represent all of Manatee County, most of half of Sarasota County. And I know Ron Turner very well, and Hillsborough. I represent a good piece of the southern part of Hillsborough. And I can just tell you, I think they all do a great job. I think our Secretary of State does a good job. I don't think there's a lot of abuse as it relates to Florida. I can't say that for other states, but I want to make sure that also people that are voting are eligible voters in terms of being a citizen, you know, that type of thing. But I think Florida's in good shape. That's my opinion.
Thank you. Before you leave, we want to ask you or give you the opportunity to say, why send you back to Congress? What are you doing, particularly as regards communities that may feel disenfranchised? Why cast their vote for you?
I think if anybody looks at not what I say, but what I do, I've been very engaged in terms of the African American communities and others. We hire, I bought one of the Ford stores in town, and it's a business that's got a very good reputation. We hire a lot of African Americans, they're very successful. And so I represent everybody. I'm a blue collar kid. My parents worked in the factory, one of six kids. And I believe if you work hard and play by the rules for all of us, you know, you should have access to the American dream. And I'm going to fight. I look at myself as like a little bit of a community cheerleader. If there's a project in Newtown or anywhere else, you can check with our friend Johnny Hunter or anybody else that really knows me, and they'll say that Vern delivers, we jokingly say, 10 times out of 10.
Well, thank you so much. We appreciate you coming today.
Thank you.
You've been here before, and we hope to see you many times more.
And let me just say, your late dad, he was all-American. He was an incredible leader for this community, and talking about voting rights and other things, he was at the forefront of all that. So he is a very fortunate, great guy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Mr. Shapiro, thank you for joining us today. We have a few questions for you that have come forward from the community, and we'll just talk a little bit about that. So, but before we start talking about policy and where you stand on different things, I'd like to have a little conversation about civility. A house divided cannot stand, is what Abraham Lincoln said. And what we notice in Congress these days is that there seems to be a lot of strife. You're either with me or against me. There's a lot of lack of bipartisanship. If you were to be in Congress, what would be your position, and how would you be working with or not with people from other sides of the House?
Well, it is fully my intention to work with both parties. I think it's absolutely essential. I think we've been missing it for a long time. I think there's some movement in that direction. In fact, there's a problem-solving caucus that goes on between Republicans and Democrats. We don't hear about it. But I do believe without a doubt, that the way forward is to work together. And I think that's part of the problem. It's been so divisive up there, and that's, which is also why I want this seat. Again, my opponent, Mr. Buchanan, has essentially voted 98.8% of the time of the Republican Party. Even as I stated before, I think we need new leadership, because at this point, there's so much animosity and so much difficulty that we're not getting anything done. There's no progress. So it's my view that we're going to have a lot of new faces in Congress, men and women, who are not going to be bringing that baggage that we had before. They're on the ground. They see how this is affecting the communities, the divisive nature. And I think they're going to work very much towards finding common ground in the major issues like health care, Medicare and Social Security, the environment. So I have high hopes for November 6th, because I believe there's going to be a lot of new faces, including my own, in Washington, and that people will work together to get things done. So, yes, I am very much for bipartisanship, and we got to move the country forward together.
Thank you for that response. Question for you. We have a tape that we're going to roll. A member of the community wants to ask about environmental protection. Let's listen.
Our waters in Florida is increasingly becoming more polluted. I would like to know what he would do to try to help control the pollution of our environment, especially our oceans that are offshore drilling that is allowed.
Well, absolutely. This current administration has relaxed essentially every environmental protection regulation. Which is amazing because, you know, EPA, Environmental Protection Regulation, the gentleman who was actually running it was the one who was suing the EPA. So certainly we have to tighten up on the EPA. Now we're seeing it in our community, the consequence when you neglect the delicate ecosystem in the environment. We're talking about red tide. It's affecting businesses. We all knew, many of us who believed in this for some time knew that it was damaging our beautiful beaches and our natural resources, but now it's affecting our economy, jobs, people are losing jobs. There are people on my campaign staff right now that we have employed because they have lost their work in the service industry or any other job. So I would do anything and everything in my power to strengthen the EPA regulations. And I think some of the things we can do for example, we really need to start transitioning from fossil fuel into renewable energy, solar panels and such. That's the big picture. But there are things we can do now. Our infrastructure needs to be redesigned to accommodate for rising sea levels and some of the flooding we're experiencing. There are definitely, we need to start working on Lake Okeechobee, and the Army Corps of Engineers has to start redirecting the nutrients away from our rivers and estuaries and ultimately into the Gulf of Mexico, which is now causing what is a prolonged red tide situation. There are things that we can do. Now, for me, I would consult the experts, the people who actually believe there is climate change and there are some destruction to our environment. And then from there, I will be their advocate in terms of legislation, because I think we all want it now. It's not really one party anymore. I can tell you from my travels that everyone is concerned about the environment. Because it's actually affecting our economy. So I would do everything within my power to strengthen it. You know, I actually have the endorsement of the League of Conservation Voters and Sierra Club because of my stance in protection of the environment. So I would be an advocate.
You mentioned earlier healthcare being an issue, and we're going to talk about that. Before we talk about healthcare, I want to talk about voting, since we are about to have an election, obviously. One of the amendments here in Florida is what we are calling, obviously, Amendment 4, the proposed amendment that has everything to do with whether or not individual rights should be restored. I'd like you to listen to a question about that and give us your response, please.
Sure.
I would ask Candidate Shapiro, where does he stand on voting rights for felons?
I believe yes on Amendment 4, number one. I think the rights of someone who has been incarcerated, served their sentence, paid their debts to society, their citizenry should be restored, they should be able to vote, no question, hands down. It's just the right thing to do. I mean, that's what we're trying to do. I mean, and that plays into a larger picture about, you know, incarceration itself. And we're talking about 60% of the people who are incarcerated are generally a nonviolent crime or maybe drug related. So once they serve their time, there's no reason for them not to have the ability to vote. That is our basic fundamental right as a citizen. So the answer to the question was I will be supporting and am supporting Amendment 4.
Another question for you I'd like to ask is a little bit about health care and universal health care, access to affordable health care. We have a question from one of our audience members. I'd like for you to hear about that too.
Okay.
Do you think this country is smart enough to figure out a way where everyone can have health care? Healthcare is really a very serious issue in this country. There are a lot of people that are going without healthcare. There are a lot of people who are paying a high amount of premiums for healthcare, and they just cannot afford it. So what is your position on the healthcare situation in this country?
Great question, and I hear that often. So let me just say that that is a concern of so many of the people that I talked to during this campaign. And by the way, that has been my life's work as a civil trial attorney, trying to help people who have been denied coverages or without insurance, trying to find them medical care in the absence of insurance. So I will tell you that I think there is a way. I absolutely do. I believe there was a start with the Affordable Care Act. But I think basically it was suffocated at birth, and it was used as a political weapon with lies and distortions. Now the whole concept is to increase the risk pool. In other words, get people to sign up, both healthy people and young people. That will therefore drive the cost down to the people with pre-existing conditions or people who would otherwise use it more. But it's also something for the young and the healthy, because all of us are just simply one illness or injury away from financial ruin. So it's not like they don't need it. It's just important that they will, by spreading the risk out, it'll lower the prices. And that's exactly what we can accomplish. And it's that's where we were heading. And I believe there is still hope that that can be done. In fact, there are many people in Congress, or at least several people in Congress, who are working with the ACA and trying to make it more accessible, more affordable. But part of that is to make sure that we promote it, not discourage people. Mr. Buchanan, for example, just voted to allow the insurance company to preclude pre-existing condition, and that's a problem, because a lot of people have pre-existing conditions, and generally speaking, that's the care that they're going to need. So you want to buy an insurance policy that when you need it, it will be there for you, and I think that's important. And so therefore, I think that we'll be able to work this out, because there are so many people who want it right now. And again, with a new Congress coming in, they're going to have to answer to their constituents like I will to mine. And I know the people of our district, our communities want it. So there's hope, and it's on its way.
Mr. Shapiro, when we talk about working together,
yes,
going to Congress, every person that sits in Congress would tell you that relationships are so critical in terms of being able to pass legislation. So if you were to go to Congress, where would you be starting in terms of forming relationships? How would you propose to get things done walking in new, not having the relationships that are so often talked about as being the key to getting things done?
Well, here's what I'm thinking. There's going to be a lot of new faces in Congress in January. They'll be elected in November. So we're all going to have to sort of meet one another. And I truly believe there is a significant amount of Republicans and Democrats who have been serving in Congress that want to work together. Again, I mentioned the Problem Solvers Caucus group. They're made up of both Republicans and Democrats. So I will seek out people of like mind who really want to get things done. And I should be able to identify them immediately. There are people who want to further their career, and there are people who want to actually get things done for the people of their community. I will find those people. I am a board-certified mediator, so I think that's a skill set that might be useful in Washington right now. So I understand, and I'm able to listen to the other side of an argument and try to reason with people and try to achieve some sort of, I won't call it, cooperation from both parties to actually get things done. And I think the key, really, is if we can get it done together and everyone takes credit, I'll call it a victory lap, then we all, both Republicans and Democrats, will have something invested in, shall we say, sell it or explaining it to our constituents, and I think it will survive better, as opposed to using whatever is passed by the Democrats or the Republicans used as a weapon against the other side in an upcoming election. We all have to work hard, take credit, and then make sure it continues to work, because we'll all, both Republicans and Democrats, will have some skin in the game, so to speak. And I think that's the way forward. And I think this is the time, because like so many people, like your viewers, they're tired of the division and they want to get something done.
So what's the first thing that you're going to work on should you be sitting in the seat after November?
Well, healthcare, because healthcare, obviously, because that affects everyone in their lives. Their work, healthy people generally are more productive people. It's also very concerning to those to be one step away from a disaster. It also, if you have health care, generally speaking, you can avoid some very terrible things if you just have regular health treatment. Diabetes, heart, you can name a bunch of conditions that if treated properly early through health care, then people do not end up in the emergency room with something catastrophic. So I think that's vital. And that's what I'm hearing from everyone in the in our community, every community. So that would be one of the first things I would want to work on, certain.
And you believe we would have the budget in the country to be able to do that, get to a solution that you're offering?
Yes, I do believe I believe it's important enough. It's a matter of priority, and I think the budget will be there. And I think if we can promote it and get people to sign up for the program, people can understand it. When you buy something in bulk, whether you go to one of the big box places, it's cheaper. Buying power of the American people. We can lower costs that way, just like why an employer pays less than someone individual, because there's more, you spread the risk.
Okay.
So you just scale that to the United States of America, and that drives the cost down.
Well, thank you for joining us today. There's so much more we want to talk about, but we're running out of time. So thank you for joining us today. And thank you, Suncoast, for joining us on Black Almanac. We'll be back.
Selfless service is the principle that guides Army National Guard soldiers to be ready whenever disaster strikes. They have a stake in the well-being of the neighborhoods where they live and work. They train part-time to be ready to serve at all times. Selfless service, it's what inspires the men and women of the Army National Guard to be part of something greater than themselves. Visit NationalGuard.com to learn more.
Thanks to the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, what was once impossible is happening today for thousands of patients with blood cancer.
I live.
I live.
I live.
I live.
I live.
She lives.
Because of the research done by the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society in the battle against blood cancer.
If you had a chance to support the research that is saving lives, what would you do?
ABC 7 News at 7, weeknights.